thank you for a very kind introduction. It is a pleasure to be able to tell something on this beautiful symposium where we have the chance to meet so many many old friends. And I want to start with acknowledging Alan, of course, acknowledging him for and congratulating him with his birthday. But I think most important contribution that he made to many of us, that he inspires us, as he did this morning, with something new, with something mind-boggling, something that keeps you thinking and that makes you thinking. And I think we owe him a lot for this. The other person that I'd like to acknowledge is actually Serdar. Also, he has also his birthday last week. And I found one of the files yesterday evening on my computer that indeed, on April 1, you will celebrate your 20th anniversary at this university. So you're 20 years in Linz. So congratulations to that, and congratulations to Linz. And I think over the years, also Serdar has inspired us a lot. But he, I think, and this is another very beautiful example of that, he is also the one that brings us together every time again. Always with a nice environment, with nice friends, and thank you, Serdar, for that. What Serdar and Alan also brought us was the combination of polymers and fullerenes. And this was my first paper that I published when I was in Santa Barbara. It looks like it's almost accepted on your birthday. I'm not sure which day that is, but this says 11 March. Must be close to that. There's some kind of small story to this. At that time, of course, Serdar discovered this electron transfer between polymers and C60, and this was now a paper where there was no electron transfer, but an energy transfer. That itself was not so, was interesting. I think the most interesting part is actually that it was the first time that we determined the triplet energy of polyalkyl thiophenes in a certain accuracy. The nice thing about this paper was that I submitted it to Journal of Chemical Physics, to Donald Levy at that time. And after a week or so, Alan got a invitation to review his own paper. and he wrote back, well, it's an excellent paper, but you shouldn't ask me. So, but it then it took not too long before it got accepted. So this was my first paper, and maybe not the most important paper, but it was an interesting contribution, an interesting experience at that time. It was less than, yeah, even at that time, that was a mail. It was by surface mail, it was, or maybe airmail, I don't know, but not email. So there was a pretty quick, maybe the editor just read the first sentence of Alan's letter as an excellent paper and didn't read the second one. I don't know.
You are the editor of
G. Yeah, no, yeah, this was not in organic electronics, but so what Serdar and Alan also brought us was, of course, this bulk heterojunction that was already in the patent that they wrote in 1993, I think, or 1992 it was. But it took until 1995 until the first real bulk heterojunction solar cell came around. And that has kept us busy for the next more than 20 years now. And there's still progress being made. And the progress is in this graph. It's a similar graph as Christoph Robert has shown us. We've gone from a few percent initially to close to 12% nowadays. And it is an increase that is due to development of better devices, but mainly due to development of new materials. And all these new materials do give better efficiencies. But what is really also important, what Christoph said this morning, was that stability and other issues are also important. So this is not yet a product. I remember in the 90s when we wrote a project proposal together with Serdar, or he was the main initiative of that, and he at that time everyone was thinking that if you have a 5% solar cell that we would sell it on the spot and that everyone would standing on our doorstep to buy it. Well, we are now at close to 12%, and these people on the doorstep still have to come, I guess. But it's progressing, and I think the important thing is that there is progress, and that there is also definitely interest from companies and from industrial developments. If you look into these new materials, then this is a graph that we published last year. We had it actually on our computer for quite some time, not knowing really what to do with it. But this is a kind of interesting graph, and also Christoph showed a slightly related graph this morning, and it shows one of the biggest problems for organic photovoltaics, and that is that the difference between the optical band gap and the open circuit voltage that we can achieve is around 0.6. Nowadays, there are a few materials emerging here at 0.4, 0.5 eV, but you would see that when you go lower here, you also lose quantum efficiency. So the materials that really have high external quantum efficiencies and also high internal quantum efficiencies, close to 100% in that case, have usually energy losses that are much larger, 0.9 volts or 1 volt. All wideband gap materials have energy losses close to 1 volt. If you go down in this energy loss, you start to lose quantum efficiency, and there's no real reason for it except that it happens. And when you reach this 0.6 volts limit, then it becomes notoriously difficult to find materials. Luckily, there's Christoph showed a new material here around this point here. There's a few new materials here from Japan. And if you really think about it, with higher quantum efficiencies, with higher fill factors that we can reach nowadays, then it's not impossible to gain materials, to have materials that are not as far away, that really are well beyond 15%. So I think we really should look for this part of the materials. These materials will not give us will give us 11, 12%, but will never give us the 15%. These materials will give us at some point the 15, 16%. And I'm a strong believer that will happen. Not knowing exactly which material to make and why some of the materials kind of almost escape this valley of death that you also have here if you make the wrong materials. This is some work that we've been doing. We're trying to push materials and try to keep these losses as low as possible. But even with materials like these, which have a reasonably moderate band gap, so it's not really wide, it's not really small, somewhere we call it a bit wide band gap at this point, but the voltage loss is not that big, it's 0.8 volts, so you get still reasonable quantum efficiencies, but what you really need is materials here that go down to 0.7 or 0.6. For intermediate band gap materials, that's a little bit easier. We have here a number of materials that where the energy loss is like 0.7 volts, with quantum efficiencies that you also see are not very high, 60, 50, 60% at maximum, something even lower. This particular material has a quite low energy loss, it's 0.66, and you see that also already starts to lose its quantum efficiency a little bit. So that is really an issue, and if you go to a really low band gap, so this is our lowest band gap that we made, at least that works in a solar cell, that's kind of difficult, and you see that by lowering the band gap at some point, you really start to also reduce the voltage, of course, because of this loss, the voltage becomes low, and that makes that the efficiency is low, despite the fact that you have quite nice quantum efficiencies. That is also, again, related to this 0.8. 0.8 makes that the quantum efficiency is a bit higher. That works reasonably well for small band gap polymers, but still, these materials are not good enough to reach ultimate goals of 15% or even higher if you would go to multi-junctions. This is, of course, Markus Schaber. He did a great job in predicting where we had to go, and we are now more or less where we were supposed to be, taking these numbers, so a gap minus VOC of 0.6 volts, a fill factor of 65, and an external quantum efficiency of 65, you can reach these numbers. Nowadays, fill factors are higher than this. Fill factors in the best materials are above 0.7, sometimes even 0.75. If you can combine two of these with these numbers into a tandem cell, you could reach 15%. If you make a triple junction cell, you could actually reach more than 15% in the future. That is still a prediction, of course. There is still, this has been achieved more or less. These two have not been achieved yet, but I think it's not for long that will happen. So we worked on these tandem configurations quite a lot. The difficulty there is really to make these devices in the end and to make sure that all the layers are present and keep their integrity. This is an example of a few years ago where we used 2 6% materials. This is a low band gap material that we developed ourselves, and this is the well-known PCD-TBT material initially developed by Mario Leclerc and also by Konarka, used a lot and give efficiencies of around 6%, at least in our hands. And if you then make a tandem cell, you can make cross-section. You see these layers, the recombination layer in the middle. And if you optimize that, then you really have to balance the two cells. So the way that we do it is that we make all the IV curves and internal quantum efficiencies of the single junctions and then calculate this as an optical electrical model to figure out which thickness combination you have to make to get the optimum power. If you make one cell too thick, it absorbs too much light. The other light cannot generate enough current and vice versa. And it's not just about generating the right amount of currents. It's really about balancing the cells because the IV curves of these materials are not flat at short circuit. There's a field dependence of the current, so you really have to optimize this carefully. And then if you make these cells, then in the favorable cases, it really works pretty nicely that the predicted value is exactly what you make and what you measure. And you can also achieve a much improved efficiency. In this case, it was close to 9%. You also see that the two materials give a nice separation of the two spectral regions. The visible part and the near-infrared part for the small band gap material. You also see that the small band gap material can generate more current, and this made us to make a triple junction at that time, a triple junction that consists of the two materials. So we take, I'll show you on the next slide, we take one layer of this one and two layers of that one. Then you have to do this optimization for three layers, so this is kind of four-dimensional curve with a middle cell, a back cell, and a front cell, and the color code that says where the highest efficiency would be. So you can do the same calculation and figure out which cell you have to make. And also that works pretty nicely, that you can make a triple junction cell. It's kind of we call it a 1+2 triple junction because you use two times the small band gap material just to increase the voltage because these two materials are not current limiting in the tandem cell. They become a bit current limiting in the triple junction cell, but all you get is a slightly higher efficiency. So that is a pretty nice. We're pretty happy with that, and then of course started to think about making triple junctions with three different materials to really use different band gaps. And this is one of the examples that we came up with. This is a very low band gap material. This one. Approaches the band gap of silicon, actually, than a what you call intermediate band gap and the wide band gap material, two DPP materials and this TPD material. All the initial efficiencies are quite okay, at 6%, and this last one is a bit lower, of course, at 2.5. This is with C60, and if we process it with C70, we get a higher efficiency, but we don't want to use that, and we don't want to use this part of the spectrum for this layer, because that part of the spectrum has to go to the wide band gap cell. If you do the calculations for this cell, the efficiency that you can generate is not that high, actually. It's not so easy to find materials, to find the good materials for wide band gap, small band gap, and intermediate band gap to reach high efficiency. So this was predicted to be close to 8%. And while making it, we never really got there. This is the best we measured so far. And this is a bit of disappointing 6%, especially if you compare it to the single junctions. There's two single junctions that are equal or even better than this triple junction. But at least it's a triple junction that works. That you can see it is the predicted value, and the IV curve misses voltage, misses current, and misses also a bit of fill factor. In the final result. You do see, however, that the external quantum efficiency, which is actually not so easy to measure with for a triple junction solar cell, gives nice contributions of the three different parts of the spectrum. So this was a kind of difficult thing. The student that did this got her PhD a few weeks ago on February 26, and for that reason she made a triple junction birthday cake. So this is not Photoshopped, it is real. I ate it. It tasted very well. So you can see here this we call the small band gap. It's usually a greenish polymer. That's why the color is green. This is the intermediate band gap. This is the white band gap, usually a reddish color. You see here the zinc oxide and the p-dot layer. You see it's a nice bulk heterojunction encapsulated. So it's a full working device in that sense. It was a nice treat to eat. So the cooking and the recipe are by Alice. Of course, there's many more that work now on these triple junction solar cells. This was a paper from Yang 2 years ago. We showed this triple junction cell consisting of three different materials, wide band gap, intermediate, and small band gap. As you can see, his small band gap material is not extending all the way up to, let's say, 1100 nanometers, and I think that is a smart trick to really improve the efficiency. So he now got this cell to 11.6%, which is the highest triple junction efficiency published so far, I guess. Except for the recent announcement then of HeliaTech, where they had in early this year, they announced that they were making an organic triple junction solar cell with three different absorber layers with an efficiency of 13.2. So that is a real nice demonstration of how far you can push this, albeit not for the time being, not with polymers. I'm sure that polymers can achieve similar values, but we have to do a little bit better. And what we really have to do is in this table, so this is a table of some of the triple junctions that were made. This is Yang's 11.6 cell. This was our 9.6. There's also 11.8 cell has been published. And if you look into the materials that have been used, there you can evaluate a bit what is good and bad about it. So here we have the wide band materials used in these materials. And I write down here the energy losses that were for the P3HT PCBA, ICBA cell, the energy loss is 1.06 volts. For this cell, it's 1.03, and here it's also a large value of close to 0.9 volts. This is a little bit better, but these are particularly poor in terms of energy loss. If you look into the intermediate gap, it's a bit better, 0.7 and 0.8. And if you look into the low band gap, that is both this one and this one, it's actually the best one, so it's around 0.7. But you do see that neither of these materials really gets to this 0.6 volts, and so that's what we really need for the future. So we would need optimized band gaps, we would really need these VOCs, and we would need freedom in the thickness to balance the subcells. This is actually an important issue. Many of the solar cells that you see being published give you 8, 9, 10%, but they are usually for an 80, 90 nanometer thick film. That is usually not enough to make a tandem cell. You really need freedom up to 200, 250 nanometers to balance currents correctly, and the cell has to work with high fill factors and high currents under all these conditions. So it's not that any, let's say, very efficient material is suitable for incorporation into a tandem or a multi-junction cell. So we don't have this, we don't have this, and we don't have that. So that's good news, because then we can still have something to do. So we need much better wide band gap materials, better intermediate band gap, and better small band gap materials. And one way that you can show that this somehow works, how to get there is a bit of a question, of course. But one way that you can show that it will work is when you do some hybrid work. So this was work that we did together with the University of Delft in the Netherlands, where they are pretty good in making amorphous silicon solar cells. So they have a long tradition in amorphous silicon, and this is the they can make by varying the deposition conditions, they can reproducibly make different types of amorphous silicon that have different band gaps, and also then give you slightly different voltages and different performance levels. If you would combine such a amorphous silicon, which actually has a pretty nice energy loss, at least much better for a wide band gap materials than the 1 volt loss that we saw in the previous slides, and also a very good quantum efficiency, of course, then you can combine such an amorphous silicon cell with a small band gap polymer cell to see if you can make a reasonable tandem and possibly triple junction solar cells. So we used three types of amorphous silicon, named 1, 2, and 3. For the tandem cell, we used two, and I'll show you later a triple junction cell where we splitted this up a little bit more and used the one and three as materials. So this is the stack, how it looks like, how the tandem stack looks like. Start with glass, flat zinc oxide, aluminum doped zinc oxide, and then a normal PIN amorphous silicon solar cell. Then the intermediate junction is, again, aluminum doped zinc oxide with a very thin layer of silver. It's 1 nanometer, and then molybdenum oxide. And on top of that, we process this small band gap polymer and just close off with a normal lithium fluoride aluminum electrode. This is the cross section that you see. This part is the recombination junction. This part is the bulk heterojunction. This part is the amorphous silicon solar cell. If you do that, you get two pretty nice tandem cells. Already, this is the amorphous silicon cell. This is the organic solar cell. This is the tandem cell, and you get a pretty nice EQE with a total efficiency of 11.6%. The things that you see here, these fringes or this fine structure, that is not noise. That is really there to, that is the optical interference that you have in these cells. The refractive indexes of these materials are quite different, with only this one having a low refractive index, but the others a higher one. And that makes the optical management that you have to do in this cell quite complex. And that also results in these dents that you see here in the external quantum efficiency. We then also moved to triple junction solar cells. So this was even more complex because the difficulty is then that the two amorphous silicon solar cells quite use the same spectrum. So what we had to do there is use a mildly textured zinc oxide. This was actually quite a hassle to do initially because we first used too much textured, and then the texture is so large that your organic solar cell makes shorts. So you have to do a mild texturing. Then you have to apply two silicon amorphous silicon cells. It's difficult to see here, but there are two of them. In the TM cross-section, you cannot see a big difference there. Then you apply this recombination zone again, the same azo, silver, and molybdenum oxide, and then the polymer again. And you have to make sure that the polymer makes a closed film and doesn't make a short, of course, between the metal back electrode and this recombination contact. That was a bit of an issue if you use it too strongly textured zinc oxide. And then you can show that that with this you can get actually somewhat higher efficiency. That was the triple, so you get to 13%, again, with a measurement of the external quantum efficiencies in the three parts that together give you the entire efficiency. We did really our best to make as good as possible efficiency measurements and as good as possible quantum efficiency measurements. But this is really a difficult task. Measuring the quantum efficiency of these things is not easy. So we think this is the right number, but it's a difficult thing. With that, I'd like to close. This is kind of the future birthday cake of an organic triple junction solar cell. Should look a bit more sophisticated than we had so far. There's a lot of things that we still have to do. We are now close to 12%. I showed you this triple amorphous silicon polymer, which is close to 13. I'm pretty sure that that within a few years we will be able to go over 15% with these cells. The best materials are not there yet, but they are approaching these criteria. And certainly now that we published last year this graph, everyone is using this. Not everyone, but quite a few people are using this graph and trying to push into that valley of death zone. And I'm pretty sure that somewhere materials will be found that escape from that, at least from the low quantum efficiencies there. This is the biggest challenge, in my view, for organic materials, to really make semiconductors that are better than we have now in terms of this optical loss. And of course, another issue that I didn't talk about, but that is really important, is these recombination contacts in the tandem cells that also sometimes still cause losses. With that, I'd like to stop. I'd like to thank everyone that worked on this. I don't have a slide with the acknowledgments because I started with that. I'd like to thank you for your attention, and again, Alan and Serdar for being so good friends. Thank you.